Hello, this is Luke Dolphin, and welcome back to Sentinels of the Multiverse weekly one-shot. This week's is number 42. Let's take a look at what it is. Don't panic! People of Earth, your attention, please. This is Grand Warlord Voss of the Galactic Hyperspace Planning Council. As you will no doubt be aware, the plans for development of the outlying regions of the galaxy require the building of a hyperspatial express route through your star system. And regrettably, your planet is one of those scheduled for demolition. The process will take slightly less than 2 of your Earth minutes. Thank you! So this looks to be Grand Warlord Voss versus the Scholar, Tempest, and the Wraith in Time Cataclysm. Interesting. It's not advanced, which is good. One of the few times that I've gotten near mint, which actually we can take a look at my collection and see, one of the few times I've gotten near mint was an advanced Voss game, when I flipped him like right away and then he played too many cards and beat me up. Oops. But this is normal. And we have, well, 3 of my favorite heroes, actually. That's good. In my favorite environment. So hopefully this goes well. Cower before the might of the Tharathian conquering fleet! Now, let's all just sit back and think a spell. No need to get all riled up. Cool. Alright, so only 3 heroes this week. We have the Scholar. The Scholar's base power, Better Living. Power, the Scholar regains 1 HP. He starts with Bring What You Need, Ongoing Limited. Power, reveal the top 3 cards of your deck. Put 2 in your hand, and 1 on the bottom of your deck. Flesh to Iron, Ongoing Elemental. At the start of your turn, either discard 1 card or destroy this card. Reduce damage dealt to the Scholar by 2. Keep Moving, One Shot. Search your deck for an elemental card and put it into play. Shuffle your deck, you may play a card. In Solid to Liquid, Ongoing Elemental. At the start of your turn, either discard 1 card or destroy this card. Whenever the Scholar would regain HP, increase the amount of HP regained by 1. Tempest. His base power is Squall. Power. Tempest deals all non-hero targets 1 projectile damage. He starts with an Aquatic Correspondence. One shot. Draw 3 cards. Ball Lightning. One shot. Tempest deals 1 target 4 lightning damage. You may destroy up to 2 ongoing cards. Chain Lightning, one shot. Tempest deals 1 target 4 lightning damage. Tempest may deal a second target 3 lightning damage. Tempest may deal a third target 2 lightning damage. And a Localized Hurricane, ongoing. Increase damage dealt to Tempest by 1. Power, Tempest deals up to 2 targets 3 projectile damage each. You may draw 2 cards. Power, destroy this card. And then Wraith, her base power, Stealth. Power, reduce the next damage that would be dealt to the Wraith by 2. She starts with a Grappling Hook. One shot. Destroy 1 ongoing or environment card. You may draw a card. Micro-targeting Computer. Equipment limited. Increase projectile damage dealt by the Wraith by 2. Suit yourself. One shot. The Wraith regains 3 HP. And Throwing Knives. Equipment limited. Power. The Wraith deals up to 3 targets, 1 projectile damage each. That's what we have to start with. So, Grand Warlord Voss. Villain Tharathian. That title Tharathian is actually, well, I guess it does matter with villain cards that say increased damage dealt by Tharathians or something. Conquering Alien Warlord. Setup. At the start of the game, Grand Warlord Voss enters play, Conquering Alien Warlord side up. Cards are revealed from the top of the villain deck until 3 minions are revealed and put into play. Other revealed cards are returned to the villain deck, which is shuffled. Gameplay. At the start of the villain turn, if there are no minions in play, Grand Warlord Voss flips. At the start of the villain turn, if there are 10 or more minions in play, the planet has been overrun by the Tharathian army. Game over. Reduce damage to Grand Warlord Voss by 2 for each minion in play. So on this side, he doesn't do anything other than have a damage reduction by 2 for each minion in play. But if we mess things up and there are 10 or more minions in play at the start of the villain turn, we all lose, even if we have HP. And he flips if there are no minions in play, which we probably want to have no minions in play so he no longer has damage reduction. When he flips, he's the Super Tharathian Warrior. Gameplay. At the start of the villain turn, if there are two or more minions in play, Grand Warlord Voss flips. Reduce damage to Grand Warlord Voss by 1 for each minion in play. At the end of the villain turn, Grand Warlord Voss deals the hero target with the highest HP 2 energy damage, and the hero target with the lowest HP 1 fire damage. So here he deals damage himself. He still has damage reduction, but it's by 1 instead of 2 for each minion in play. And if at the start of the villain turn there happen to be 2 or more in play, he flips back. But generally, we would want Voss to be on this side, because it's much easier to hit him. We really don't want him to stay on this side unless there was some way we could overcome the damage reduction by 2. Like, we could keep him on this side permanently if we keep one minion in play, but then we'd have to deal with Voss having damage reduction by 2. One last thing to point out is that Tempest and Voss are nemeses, so they will do one more point of damage to each other. With that said, let's start the game. We start with 3 minions. First one, Genebound Soldier. Minion. This card is immune to projectile damage. At the end of the villain turn, this card deals the hero target with the highest HP 2 projectile damage. We have a Genebound Firesworn. Minion. This card is immune to fire damage. At the end of the villain turn, this card deals the hero target with the highest HP 2 fire damage. And Genebound Shock Infantry, Minion. This card is immune to lightning damage. At the end of the villain turn, this card deals the hero target with the highest HP 3 lightning damage. So each of these minions are associated with a damage type, and they deal that damage type. They're also immune to that damage type. But these aren't really the worst ones of the bunch. The card play, Genebound Soldier. We've already read that, so we have 2 of those. Bear in mind, Genebound Soldiers are immune to projectile damage, and the Wraith, only deals projectile damage. So the Wraith won't be able to hit these, and Tempest can't deal them damage with his base power. I say his, but Tempest is actually a gender. I'm not really sure how to refer to him. It seems a bit too informal, so maybe we just avoid pronouns with regards to Tempest. Tempest can't hit him with Tempest's base power. There we go. So these seem to be automatic. Oh, we have a tie for highest HP. The next one is going to hit the highest HP for 2. Is this also a highest HP? Oh yeah, these are all highest HP. That's pretty nice. Let's see, do these guys... I guess, let's see. I mean, the Wraith has HP recovery in her hand, but I don't really generally play that card. Tempest has a localized Hurricane. He might want to play that. It's a great card, but he will take more damage while it's out. So maybe we should give a bigger hit to Tempest so that he's not the highest HP after the fact. And that's the first turn. So here we are with the Scholar. So the Scholar's base power, regain 1 HP. But he has an element card called, or elemental card, Mortal Form to Energy. Whenever he regains HP, he can also deal one target that much energy damage. And it's a great card because it combos with basically a lot of his cards. He has a lot of HP recovery in his deck. And if we can, you know, get those cards and play those cards in addition to his base power, we'll be able to really chain Mortal Form to Energy with damage dealing. That being said, there is an effective counter to the minions that are already in play. This card deals the hero target with the highest HP. This card deals damage to the hero target with the highest HP. This card deals damage to the hero target with the highest HP. And this card deals damage to the hero target with the highest HP. And the current hero with the highest HP is the Scholar. If he plays Flesh to Iron, he will have damage reduction by 2. So this is reduced by 2. This is reduced by 2, this is reduced by 2, this is reduced by 2. Unless, for some reason, he takes damage on the environment turn, or the Wraith recovers HP, in which case he won't be the highest HP. But after reducing by 2, the only card that will deal damage is the Genebound Shock Infantry, and we can probably get rid of him with Tempest and Wraith, potentially, so we don't really have to worry about that damage so much. So Flesh to Iron is probably a smart play, just because it will prevent a lot of damage incoming. The Genebound Soldiers we're not really going to be able to deal with with Tempest, unless he plays Chain Lightning or Ball Lightning, and Wraith won't be able to do it herself. So I think we're going to play Flesh to Iron. His base power, regain 1 HP. This is probably wise. I mean, sometimes you don't really want the Scholar to regain too much HP, because then Mortal Form to Energy is a dead card if he's at maximum HP. But at least this will cement his position as a maximum HP hero. And we draw an Alchemical Redirection. Ongoing, redirect all damage that would be dealt to hero targets to the Scholar. At the start of your turn, destroy this card. When combined with Flesh to Iron, this is great. In fact, when combined with Flesh to Iron, this is effectively Skyscraper's Thorathian Monolith across two cards. Except we can keep the damage reduction if we feed it with card discards. And since Scholar is the highest HP hero, it's a little more safe to play Localized Hurricane, and since it deals two targets 3 projectile damage each, it will enable us to take out the Genebound Firesworn and the Genebound Shock Infantry, because they are not immune to projectile damage. This will also enable Wraith to not have to play Throwing Knives, or just to prefer to use her base power. And the real power of Localized Hurricane is that you get to draw two cards, which is nice. So we'll localize the Hurricanes. And now when you use Localized Hurricane, you sort of have to be careful. If you reflexively just press card, press power, you'll usually hit destroy this card. They actually fixed this several months ago, that if you click this, it will... I'm tempted to do it. I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to test this out for you. You should see it for yourself. But if you tap this by mistake, it will pull up a second box that says confirm. This was because of the repeated feedback, especially in the one-shots, where people would play Localized Hurricane and then immediately destroy it by that power. But we're going to use the first power. Deal up to 2 targets, 3 projectile damage each. Now, Tempest is Grand Lord Voss's nemesis, but with 4 minions out, he has damage reduction by 8. So the 3 plus 1 is 4, that is still much less than 8, so we might as well just hit the other cards. So let's just first hit the Genebound Shock Infantry, because that's the one that is only capable of hitting Scholar currently. And we'll also hit the Genebound Firesworn. And now we draw 2 cards in addition to our end of turn card draw. We draw another Ball Lightning, we draw another Localized Hurricane, and our card draw is a Shielding Winds, ongoing limited. Whenever a hero target would be dealt 5 or more damage from a single source, reduce that damage by 2. So, offline, I've been playing a lot of games with the Prime Wardens. The Prime Wardens are the Argent Adept, Captain Cosmic, Fanatic, Haka, and Tempest. I've not been playing with the variants that are actually called Prime Wardens, because they're not in the digital game yet. But I've seen a lot of use of Shielding Winds from several villains that hit for that much. In fact, I played against Advanced Chairman, and Shielding Winds basically permanently reduces his retaliation damage by 2 with that setup. Because Advanced Chairman, on his flip side, the first time he would be dealt damage each turn, he would deal the source of that damage 5 melee damage with 5 heroes on Advanced. So reduce that by 2, it's now 3, and it effectively... undoes the Advanced rule. Anyway, so there are no ongoing cards or environment cards to destroy, and there's no need to recover HP. In fact, we'll recover beyond... Actually, no, her maximum is 26, yeah. So she would be tied with Scholar still, but we don't want her to go over Scholar currently. Micro-targeting computer could be played. And in that case, if I get a different power, or a different weapon, like the Stun Bolt, or what's the other one? The Razor Ordnance, then I could power that up versus Throwing Knives. But I'm pretty sure since we can't hit any of the villain targets, we probably are just going to use her base power. Alternatively, we could skip twice and draw 2 cards, but we would like to get equipments out in general for Wraith. If you've never played Grand Lord Voss before, but you're familiar with Sentinel mechanics, Grand Warlord Voss has very few hero card destruction cards. In fact, the only one that he has is the TCF Conqueror, that at the start of the villain turn, destroy one hero ongoing card. So even if this card gets played, you still wait one round before you have to destroy one hero ongoing card. But this doesn't say anything about equipment cards. None of his cards say anything about equipment cards. So equipment cards against Voss are very safe to play. Time Cataclysm, slightly different. I think there are no equipment destruction cards, as far as I can tell. There is a card that destroys all hero ongoing cards. There's a card that destroys one hero ongoing card. Those are both at the start of the environment turn. That's not it. And I guess that's it. So these are still like a card is played and then you have one round to deal with it. So ongoing cards are slightly less safe than a standard Voss game, but they can still be a little more permanent. Long story short, it's fine to play any equipment because it's unlikely to get destroyed by Voss, or it will never be destroyed by Voss or Time Cataclysm. So let's go ahead and put out the micro-targeting computer, and it's going to be out the entire game until we destroy it with Inventory Barrage, and then we'll use her stealth power to reduce the next damage that would be dealt to the Wraith by 2. Slightly less effective than the Scholar's permanent damage reduction, but it will at least be a safeguard in case something goes past the Scholar, being the highest HP. And we draw a second copy of Micro-Targeting Computer, so it's not another weapon. Environment plays Rift in Time. At the end of the environment turn, play the top card of the environment deck. At the start of the environment turn, destroy one environment card. So generally, cards that say play more cards for either the environment deck or the villain deck are dangerous cards. But Rift in Time is rather interesting because you will get another environment card. But at the start of the environment turn, you get to destroy one environment card. And generally, you would probably want to destroy Rift in Time, but if you get a terrible environment card that you don't want to have in play, you could have Rift in Time destroy it, and the penalty would be another card play, but, you know, if you don't have a means of destroying the bad cards yourself, you can have Rift in Time guide you. So the environment plays Marsquake. Anomaly. At the end of the environment turn, deal each target 2 melee damage. At the start of the environment turn, destroy one villain ongoing card, one hero ongoing card, and one environment card. So this also destroys an environment card itself at the start of the environment turn, but it also destroys a villain ongoing card first, then a hero ongoing card second, before it destroys the environment card. Plus it deals damage across the board right now. So in fact, it's good that we used Wraith Stealth, because now Wraith won't take this damage. But Tempest will take 3 damage because of localized Hurricane. Scholar won't take damage, but the Genebound Soldiers will take damage, and they'll be down to 1 HP each, which is nice. But we're going to have to see what we're going to do with regards to that card. Order doesn't matter. 2 damage to Voss will be reduced to -2, and these cards will not be destroyed, so order doesn't matter at all. Alright, so Voss is not flipping, and he plays First Lieutenant Victor, Thrathian. Increased damage dealt to hero targets by 1. So in fact, Scholar will be taking damage because of First Lieutenant Victor, but still tied for highest HP, which is nice. So here we are. So Marsquake, if we choose to like have Rift in Time destroy itself, then Marsquake will also destroy itself, but first it will destroy a hero ongoing card. There's no way to keep Marsquake in play at all. Either we destroy it with Rift in Time, or it gets destroyed by itself. So the question is, do we want Rift in Time to destroy it? Do we want Wraith to destroy it with Grappling Hook? Or do we want to lose an ongoing card and lose both Rift in Time and Marsquake? The first question, though, the one that's predominantly on the screen, is do we want to discard a card to keep Flesh to Iron in play? And I believe that is wise. I believe if we can keep Flesh to iron out this entire game, it'll be a much safer game, because then all the damage being dealt to the highest HP hero will always hit Scholar. On the other hand, the damage that's going to the lowest HP hero will usually be Tempest. So, since we have to play... Well, we don't have to play a card. We have to discard a card to keep Flesh to Iron. If we choose to play a card, and then our power doesn't give us card draws, and the card we play doesn't give us card draws, and then we draw a card at the end of our turn, we're losing one card per turn. So, a way to profit cards would be to play Bring What You Need. And not only does it profit you two cards with the power, but you get to cycle through the top three cards of your deck. And if one card is one you know you don't want, you can put it on the bottom of your deck and you can get to the better cards faster. Anyway, I believe of these four cards, Solid to Liquid is the least nice. Increasing the amount of HP the Scholar can regain by one is sometimes a nice way to give Scholar a damage boost, because if he uses his base power with what I previously mentioned, Mortal Form to Energy, he will only hit one target for one energy damage. So if they have any damage reduction, it doesn't go through. But with Solid to Liquid, that HP is increased by one, so you regain two HP and then can deal two energy damage. But with Flesh to Iron and Solid to Liquid, Scholar is very likely to cap out on HP, so I'm going to lose the Solid to Liquid. And if I really want it back, I could play a Keep Moving later to get it, but for now, I think I'm going to bring what I need, and we'll look at the top three cards in my deck. We find Know When to Hold Fast. One shot. Draw five cards immediately end your turn. Offensive Transmutation. One shot. The Scholar deals one target two infernal damage. A target dealt damage this way cannot deal damage until the start of your next turn. And another Bring What You Need. So, this card is limited, and a copy is already in play. So, ongoings... If we destroy one ongoing card, and the card we choose to destroy is Bring What You Need, we could play our second Bring What You Need, and therefore Marsquake doesn't hurt us. Know When to Hold Fast, when combined with Bring What You Need... Or sorry, not when combined. When you play this, your turn ends immediately, but with... If you use Bring What You Need, you'd get two cards, and then you draw a card at the end of your turn. There are other cards in his deck that could potentially let you draw five cards in your turn without having to end your turn immediately. Because this does prevent you from drawing a card at the end of your turn, so it's basically draw four cards, skip your power phase, draw a card. Sort of. It's not quite that way. And you can really see what I mean by that if you're playing against Wagermaster and he plays a card that reverses the turn orders, or not the turn orders themselves, but the order of phases. Because if you end your turn, you're at your end of turn phase, it then becomes your draw phase. But anyway, I think Know When to Hold Fast, although it's nice to get cards, I feel like with Bring What You Need, if we choose to let it be destroyed, I don't think there's another ongoing. I guess we could play Localized Hurricane, but I would rather be a little more set up. So... Yeah, let's put Bring What You Need in your hand. We'll put Offensive Transmutation in our hand. Know When to Hold Fast is on the bottom of our deck. We draw Transmutive Recovery. One shot. The Scholar regains 2 HP. Draw 2 cards. Alright. So another option we had was for Tempest to play a second Localized Hurricane and have Marsquake destroy that one, since Localized Hurricane is not limited. But I would like to be slightly more set up. I don't know if Shielding Winds is what we would want, though. What is the chances of us being dealt 5 or more damage from a single source? Well, let's see. Voss on his flip side... He deals the hero target with the highest HP 2 energy damage. That is almost always going to be Scholar at this point. Hero target with the lowest HP 1 fire. That is almost always Tempest. With a Nemesis boost, that's 2. And with this damage increase, that's 3. That's still less than 5. I don't think any of these cards deal more than 3 damage. Yeah, all of them do 3 damage, and none of them are nemeses of Tempest. I mean, if they were out in conjunction with First Lieutenant Victor and localized Hurricane, then it would be 5 damage. But it seems rare for 5 damage to be dealt. In fact, I think even the environment only does 3 damage at most. So, I don't think shielding winds is the right play after all. What I would really like Tempest to have is a damage reduction card to counter the increased damage effect of localized Hurricane. Especially if Voss flips, in which case he will be hitting Tempest for a lot. So I feel like playing Aquatic Correspondence to get 3 cards is good. Ball Lightning we probably want to hold on to in case Force Deployment comes out. That's the only ongoing card Voss has, but when it gets destroyed, it puts all minions from the villain trash into play. And so we would like to have them come out before the villain turn just so we can deal with them better. And Chain Lightning would allow us to get rid of the Genebound Soldiers faster, since it's lightning damage. But they're currently harmless, with the exception of with the side effect of we can't hit Voss currently. I think we're gonna Aquatic Correspondence. So let's do that. We get Cleansing Downpour, ongoing, power. Each hero target regains 2 HP. This is one of the best HP recovery cards in the game, in my opinion. And this card is really good when combined with Scholar's Mortal Form to Energy, because each hero target regains 2 HP, and then the Scholar deals 1 target 2 energy damage. That's a means of doing damage while still regaining HP. And we get a Reclaim from the Deep. One shot. Each player may take a card from their trash and put it on top of their hero deck. You may draw a card. And a Genebound Shackles. Equipment limited. Increased damage dealt by Tempest to the villain target with the highest HP by 2. So that's almost always going to be Voss, and equipments are permanent in this game, so that's a great thing. But again, we'll localize the Hurricanes. We can hit First Lieutenant Victor for 3, and Wraith will be able to deal with him. Still can't hit Voss, and there's no point in hitting anyone else. These guys are immune to projectile damage, so we'll stop. We'll draw 2 cards. We get another Cleansing Downpour. We get Into the Stratosphere. One shot. Select 1 non-indestructible villain card in play other than a character card and put it on top of the villain deck. Tempest deals the villain target with the highest HP 2 projectile damage. This is one of the best cards in the game because it gets rid of a nasty card that's in play. It's only temporary, but it gets put on top of the villain deck, which means that you know exactly what the next card play on the villain turn is. So not only do you temporarily get rid of a bad card, but it is the next card play on the villain deck. So for example, if forced deployment comes out and we're not ready for it, we could play Into the Stratosphere, put the Forced Deployment on top of the villain deck, and that way it comes out the next turn. We have 1 more round to prepare for the deployment of minions. It's especially great if you have another hero after Tempest that can discard the top card of the villain deck, or can reveal cards from the top of the villain deck and put 1 on top and 1 on bottom, which Wraith is capable of, or if the environment has the means of discarding cards. I don't think Time Cataclysm does. But it's a means of getting rid of Forced Deployment without destroying Forced Deployment, which is nice. And the card draw is Grievous Hailstorm. Ongoing. Power. Tempest deals each non-hero target 2 cold damage. This is not projectile, so this will hit the Genebound Soldiers. So if we want to get rid of First Lieutenant Victor, we have to use the Throwing Knives together with Micro-Targeting Computer. So we'll do that. And this will deal 3 projectile damage. Basically, Tempest's power, Tempest's localized Hurricane's damage without the Nemesis bonus on Voss, so there's no point in doing anything else again. And we draw a Utility Belt. Equipment limited. You may use an additional power during your power phase. So Wraith's starting to get pretty well set up. So if we destroy Rift in Time, then Mars Quake will destroy one of our ongoing cards. if we have Marsquake destroy itself, or if we destroy Marsquake with Rift in Time, then Rift in Time is going to play two environment cards. I'm a little more inclined to destroy Rift in Time because I'm more willing to destroy Bring What You Need and play my second copy of it. So we'll have Rift in Time destroy itself. Marsquake can't destroy a villain ongoing card. We can destroy Bring What You Need. I could destroy a Localized Hurricane, I suppose. I do have another copy of it in my hand if I really wanted to play it. And I don't need card draws as much anymore. I have a lot of the cards that I would want to have. Especially since all these cards are currently immune to projectile or can't deal damage. Maybe I'll just destroy Localized Hurricane. That's what I'll do. That way, Tempest has a damage reduction. Marsquake is destroyed. And Surprise Shopping Trip. Anomaly. Whenever a card enters play, deal each target one melee damage. At the start of the environment turn, destroy this card. So it was actually good timing that I destroyed Localized Hurricane, because otherwise Surprise Shopping Trip would really hurt Tempest. Since it's dealing one melee damage, it will actually... Nope, never mind. Field Lieutenant Tamar, Thorathian. Reduce damage dealt to Thorathians and minions by one. So, Surprise Shopping Trip prevents... Or not, sorry. The First Lieutenant Tamar prevents Surprise Shopping Trip from hitting these minions who otherwise would have been dealt with. Which is annoying. But the minions still can't hit us. So, discard a card. And since we didn't destroy Bring What You Need, I think I'm going to discard Bring What You Need. Since it's still in play and it's limited. So now we really want to try to get rid of Field Lieutenant Tamar. Anytime I play a card, Tempest and Wraith will take one melee damage each. So unless I play Alchemical Redirection, in which case all damage will be redirected to the Scholar so they won't take damage. And since they have damage reduction, a lot of these cards are slightly less effective. I wish now I hadn't lost Localized Hurricane, but I guess I could play Localized Hurricane and try to whittle down Field Lieutenant Tamar. Alternatively, I could into the Stratosphere it. Except I wanted to hold on to that, really. I could Chain Lightning, I guess. That will deal with 3 damage, and then Wraith could hit it for 2. And then Voss would be by himself. Yeah, that's probably what I'm going to do with Tempest. So, to save Tempest and Wraith from getting hit too much, I mean, it's still early in the game, so they have a lot of HP. They could just weather the Surprise Shopping Trip storm, but I think I'm just going to alchemically redirect everything. So now everything that would hit hero targets will be redirected to the Scholar, and since this is one melee damage, it will become -1 to Scholar. The villain targets will not take anything, so this is just a whole lot of nothing. Surprise Shopping Trip is just a dead animation right now. I know a lot of people who might play this game by themselves would just skip all of these animations, but I like letting them play out because it gives me an opportunity to take a drink. And when all you do is talk for 2 hours, your throat gets quite dry. Reveal the top 3 cards of your deck. We see a Keep Moving, a Mortal Form to Energy, which technically we haven't read, Ongoing Elemental. At the start of your turn, either discard one card or destroy this card. Whenever the Scholar regains HP, the Scholar also deals one target that much energy damage. And we get Proverbs and Axioms. One shot. Each player draws one card. Each hero character card may either regain 2 HP or deal themselves 3 psychic damage and use a power. And I think Wraith is the one depicted. That's Wraith is usually covering her face. Listen, I didn't come here to talk about legacy. Who are you? Flavor texts are awesome sometimes. Actually, I think another one of my favorites is this one. Pay attention. I am not a ghost. Do not be alarmed. I don't know what Flesh to Irons is. Show me your worst. I have weathered more than you could guess. Not particularly exciting. And then Solid to Liquid. That is French. I don't know how to read French. Sorry. All right, so Proverbs and Axioms is a card I definitely want in my hand. That is one of the best cards in the game. It allows heroes to use powers outside of their turn or regain HP, and everyone gets a card, so it's a really good card. Now, Keep Moving versus Mortal Form to Energy. Since this is being put on the bottom of my deck, Keep Moving would be able to access it. Search your deck for an elemental card and put it into play. I could put Mortal Form to Energy in play. So this card allows me to get Mortal Form to Energy if I so want it. But the benefit is I get to play a card after I play Keep Moving versus Mortal Form to Energy. It would be my only card play this turn. So if I play Keep Moving, for instance, and then I put a Mortal Form to Energy out, and then my next card play is a Transmutive Recovery, I regain 2 HP, and then I can deal 1 target 2 energy damage. And then I get to draw 2 cards, which basically funds the discards for that. So Keep Moving is going to be put in my hand, Mortal Form to Energy on the bottom of my deck. And then my draw for my end of turn, get out of the way! One shot. The Scholar deals each non-hero target 1 fire damage. Then, the Scholar regains X HP, where X is the number of targets dealt damage this way. This is especially great when comboed with Mortal Form to Energy, but it's a means of hitting everything, so it's a good card. Alright, so if we want to get Field Lieutenant Tamar out, as well as the Gene-bound Soldiers, which will thereby flip Voss, and since he's not going to be able to hit Scholar, since his damages are all for 2 or less, let's go ahead and play Chain Lightning. This is another empty animation, also known as Drink Break. I suppose we could say this is the Sentinels drinking game. Every time the surprise shopping trip goes off, take a drink. Get drunk this turn. So in order for Field Lieutenant Tamar to be destroyed by Wraith, we have to deal it the maximum damage. And then this still won't hit Voss, because this is 3 plus 1 minus 4 minus 1 is negative 1. So I might as well hit the Gene-bound Soldiers with this. You might say, why would we want to do that if Surprise Shopping Trip would take it out? Actually, it wouldn't take it out, because Wraith would be destroying Field Lieutenant Tamar on her power phase, and therefore no card would be played, and Surprise Shopping Trip wouldn't act. So we do want to get rid of the Gene-bound Soldiers while we still can. So we'll hit one of them, which destroys it, and then we'll destroy the other one. And now there are no minions, so at the start of Voss's turn, he will flip. And now Tempest's base power. You might say 1 minus 1 is 0, why would you want to do this? But Tempest is a nemesis of Voss, so it will get past the damage reduction. And we have dealt our first blood. One down, 89 to go. We draw another Reclaim from the Deep. So now, Wraith. Surprise Shopping Trip will destroy itself, so we do not need to grappling hook it. And Suit Yourself will put Wraith at higher HP than Scholar, even though all damage will be redirected to Scholar for the time being. So, and since the equipments are permanent, let's play the Utility Belt, because this will let Wraith take an extra power. And then again, this doesn't hit anyone. So take a drink. But now let's use Throwing Knives. This is our first of 2 powers. I will use Throwing Knives. We'll hit Field Lieutenant Tamar. Destroys Field Lieutenant Tamar. So now Voss has 0 damage reduction. No minions in play. No Field Lieutenant Tamar in play. This hits Voss for 3. That's 3 times as good as Tempest did, but Tempest had to deal with damage reduction, so no more damage being dealt. We have a second power to use, so we might as well use Stealth. Reduce the next damage dealt to Wraith by 2. And then we draw an infrared eyepiece. Equipment. Power. Reveal the top 2 cards of the villain deck. Put one of them on top of the villain deck, and the other on the bottom. Draw a card. So, as I said, the Wraith is capable of manipulating the villain deck, and this is the card that does it. So if Force Deployment comes out, there is a way to get rid of it before it acts. And once things are finished animating, Surprise Shopping Trip All right, Rift in Time comes back out. Rift in Time reveals a charging Triceratops, Anomaly Dinosaur. Reduce damage dealt to this card by 1. At the start of the environment turn, this card deals the target other than itself with the second lowest HP 3 melee damage. Now Voss flips. Genebound Bionaut, Minion. This card is immune to toxic damage. At the end of the villain turn, this card deals the hero target with the lowest HP 2 toxic damage. So then, can't hit Scholar, can't hit Scholar, can't hit Scholar, whoop-de-doo. And then Alchemical Redirection is destroyed. Oh, sorry, Flesh to Iron is the first choice here. Alright, so let me finish talking about what I was going to say. Flesh to Iron is annoyingly in the way here. So, what I was talking about earlier with Into the Stratosphere, if a Force deployment comes out, I could have Tempest put it on top of the villain deck, and then Wraith could utilize Infrared Eyepiece to put it on the bottom of the villain deck. And therefore, even though it was played, it was put on the bottom of the villain deck before it could act. So Voss can't get his minions back. So with these two cards, this game is a lot safer. Another thing I wanted to point out, it usually seems like Wraith's base powers across all of her variants aren't particularly exciting. I guess because the sort of intention is that she's supposed to be built up by her equipment cards that provide alternate powers that are better than her base power. But Stealth is actually a pretty nice power. It says reduce the next damage that would be dealt to the Wraith by 2. It's a damage prevention card. Not really prevention. Prevention's stronger than reduction. But it's sort of like a preparatory measure. If you anticipate Wraith being dealt damage, you can use this to prevent that damage. Sometimes it might seem like it's a little boring, but imagine that the power were instead the Wraith regains 2 HP. Then it's almost the same effect, except it's you get the HP first, and then, you know, the next time she takes damage, you know your HP is higher than what it would have been otherwise. It's not really the same thing as regain 2 HP, because if the Wraith takes 1 damage, then Stealth reduces it to negative 1, so it just prevents 1 damage. But it's basically like HP recovery, but in advance. Or, not in advance. It's HP recovery insurance, sort of. And it's actually stronger, because if Wraith is reduced to 0 first, she can't regain 2 HP and come back to life. That's just one thing I wanted to point out about that power that I was thinking about. Actually, I was thinking about it last week. Because I feel like I usually think like reduced damage cards are sort of like not really dead cards, but I don't want to waste the power using them. But like I would prefer to have this card out permanently and have permanent damage reduction, but it's fine to have it as a power. It's basically HP recovery backwards. Anyway, if we want to keep Flesh to Iron, we have to discard a card. A lot of these cards are nice. Question is, do we wish to keep Flesh to Iron? This game's a lot safer now, so I don't really need to prevent damage that much. I might actually want Scholar to take damage so that we can have him regain HP and therefore have Mortal Form to Energy trigger. Especially if we start utilizing Cleansing Downpour, not that I might. Not that I would necessarily do that, because Tempest has more damage dealing potential against Voss, especially with Nemesis boost. But it's at least a thought. I think we are going to destroy Flesh to Iron and exchange it for a Mortal Form to Energy or 2. Yeah, I don't think I'm too worried about Scholar's HP currently, so we'll skip. Flesh to Iron's gone. Alchemical Redirection is gone. Scholar without an element is certainly a little naked, so let's keep moving into something. So we already lost the Flesh to Iron. It'd be a little silly to put it in play. Definitely want to get Mortal Form to Energy versus Solid to Liquid. Like, it's fine to put Mortal Form to Energy together with Solid to Liquid, but we should probably start at least with a Mortal Form to Energy. Second question is, what do we play next? I could play my second keep moving and get a second mortal form to energy. In fact, I'm probably going to do that. I just really like mortal form to energy. So now my third card play. So if I use Transmutive Recovery, I'll regain 2 HP, and then my two mortal forms to energy will trigger, and the Scholar can deal 2 energy damage twice. Charging Triceratops, I'm not particularly worried about. He has damage reduction, so I don't really want to try to hit him. So I probably would want to hit, like, Voss. But Voss currently has one minion in play, so he has damage reduction by one as well. So I would probably want to try to get rid of the Genebound Bionaut myself. If I use Get Out of the Way, I would only hit the Genebound Bionaut. So I would deal 1 fire damage. I'd regain 1 HP, so I could deal 1 energy damage twice, which would take out the Genebound Bionaut, but that's a little boring. That's a little, you know, pedestrian get out of the way play. Transmutive, or offensive transmutation, deal 2 infernal damage, preventing damage being dealt. I could do it on Voss, even though he has damage reduction. It will get through, and then he can't deal damage, but I want him to hit Scholar. Proverbs and Axioms, each player draws a card, each hero character card can either regain 2 HP or deal themselves damage to use a power. And I mean, Tempest has a lot of cards and a lot of options. Wraith probably wants to get a second damage dealing weapon. So I think we're going to Proverbs and Axioms. So Scholar draws the Grace Under Fire. One shot. Scholar deals 1 target X radiant damage, where X is the number of non-hero targets in play. Tempest draws another Grievous Hailstorm. And Wraith draws a Combat Stance. Ongoing limited. The first time the Wraith is dealt damage by a target each turn, the Wraith deals that target 2 melee damage. So we do have a choice of order here. And we are rather high on HP, so Tempest and Wraith probably are going to opt to use powers. Maybe. Maybe not Tempest so much, actually. But if Wraith uses Throwing Knives, we can get rid of the Genebound Bionaut first. So Wraith will hit herself. Stealth reduces it by 2. So basically we regain 2 HP after using that thing, so only 1 point of damage, that's good. We'll use Throwing Knives, and we'll take out the Genebound Bionaut first. And then, now that that's gone, our next focus is on Voss, who will take 3 damage unreduced. And I might as well hit the Charging Triceratops. So now Tempest can't hit the Triceratops because of damage reduction. He can't hit Voss, and as a nemesis, that would be increased by 1. So he'd deal 2 projectile damage to Voss, at the cost of doing 3 psychic damage to himself. I'm a little less inclined to do that, because Voss will hit Tempest for 2 fire damage at the start of his next turn, and Tempest right now is perpetually the lowest HP hero. So we probably don't want Tempest to hit himself so much. We probably want to try to give Tempest HP recovery when possible, so I think Tempest is going to opt to regain HP. Now the Scholar. He could regain 2 HP, and then the mortal forms to energy will trigger, and we can hit Voss for 4 damage total. Or we could hit the Charging Triceratops for 1 point of damage twice, or we could do 1 point of damage to the Charging Triceratops, 2 to Voss. I think we'll focus more on Voss. Alternatively, we deal ourselves 3 psychic damage and use a power, such as Bring What You Need. And then our power phase, we can't use Bring What You Need, we could use Better Living. But I think he's going to regain the HP, because that will deal more damage. Alright. So now we have 2 mortal forms to energy. So if I use Better Living, he'll regain 1 HP and will deal 1 point of damage twice. Which isn't 100% exciting. Bring What You Need will give him 2 cards, which will fund the mortal form to energies currently. Now, Transmutive Recovery also funds the Transmutive Recoveries, but a lot of these are nice cards. Grace Under Fire is not 100% exciting. It's probably discard fodder. I mean, like, it has high damage dealing potential, but In this game, it's unlikely for there to be a large number of non-hero targets. Offensive transmutation currently is going to do the same amount of damage as Grace Under Fire, with the added benefit of having damage prevention. And Get Out of the Way is, well, I guess it has the same issues as Grace Under Fire, as there won't be a large number of non-hero targets, but at least it will combo with Mortal Form to Energy. But I think I'm going to use Bring What I Need, because I do want Scholar to take... I want Scholar to be able to take more damage, so he has, you know, he has enough HPs. We have another Grace Under Fire, a Transmutive Recovery, and a Get Out of the Way. Transmutive Recovery is definitely one we want. Get Out of the Way, I think we said, had more power than Grace Under Fire. And we draw a Flesh to Iron. So we do have enough cards that we could use to get rid of. So Grievous Hailstorm will do one more point of damage to these other two guys. Genebound Shackles will do two more points of damage to Voss. There's nothing to Stratosphere currently. Localized Hurricane would do two more points of damage to these guys, as well as give us card draws at the expense of Tempest taking more damage. Although, Charging Triceratops is currently going to go after Wraith for 3 melee, which will put Wraith below Tempest. So my actually Localized Hurricane might be, again, what we want. Even though we had destroyed it previously, I think... Yeah, I'm going to play Localized Hurricane, I think. Yes! So... Voss takes 4. Charging Triceratops takes 2. We draw 2 cards. Elemental Subwave Inducer, equipment limited. At the start of your turn, select a damage type. All damage dealt by Tempest this turn is of that type. Reduce damage to Tempest of that type by 1 until the start of your next turn. This is a nice card that we can use to reduce the fire damage that Voss is doing to Tempest. The only issue is when you play it, you have to wait one round for it to activate. Unless you manage to get it played out of turn, which I don't think we can do in this game. But it at least can reduce fire damage to Tempest, as well as have Tempest's damage type be different than minions that come out. So we can get past damage immunities that way. We get another Chain Lightning, and in our card draw, we get another Chain Lightning. Tempest almost has 1/3 of his deck in his hand. Alright, so Infrared Eyepiece would give us a means of preventing Voss from playing a bad card, as well as give Wraith more card draws. I'd probably be more inclined to play Combat Stance, but let's see, Combat Stance will do 2 points of damage, so if the Charging Triceratops hits Wraith, it will do Wraith will hit it for 1 point of damage, and then Throwing Knives will deal it 2 damage, so it still won't be destroyed, although it could be destroyed by a Localized Hurricane. But Localized Hurricane plus Throwing Knives will destroy it anyway, so I don't need to do that. And I probably want to make sure Wraith is a little lower than Tempest so that the fire damage goes towards Wraith for now. So I think we do want Wraith to take slightly more damage, so I think we're going to go ahead and play the Infrared Eyepiece. And now let's go ahead, Throwing Knives. No point in hitting anyone else. I guess we could hit Scholar. I mean, we could hit Scholar just so he has more HP to regain. But I think we're not at risk of him maxing out right now, so let's not worry about that just yet. And then let's go ahead and control the villain deck a little bit. We get a Force Deployment. Ongoing, when this card is destroyed, take all of the minion cards from the villain trash and put them into play. At the start of the villain turn, destroy this card. We also get a Genebound Banshee. Minion, this card is immune to sonic damage. At the end of the villain turn, this card deals the hero with the most ongoing cards 3 sonic damage. So ordinarily, you wouldn't want Force Deployment to come out, because then it forces the minions to come out. But since Tempest has Into the Stratosphere, we could have Force Deployment be played into the Stratosphere onto the top of the villain deck, and then Wraith could put it on the bottom of the villain deck, And that way, Force Deployment is a dead card. On the other hand, what if we do that, and Wraith does Infrared Eyepiece and reveals two Force Deployments? In fact, we might prefer to save that card for the case that where that does happen. So let's put the Genebound Banshee on top to be safe. In fact, this is sort of the situation as if we had already done Into the Stratosphere, so it's no point enforcing the Into the Stratosphere play unnecessarily. So now we know exactly what Voss is playing next. Wraith draws an Inventory Barrage. One shot, destroy all of your equipment cards. The Wraith deals one target X projectile damage, where X equals 2 times the number of cards destroyed this way. And her card draw is another Suit Yourself. So the Charging Triceratops. Oh yeah, Rift in Time. We could have it destroy the Charging Triceratops, but let's destroy Rift in Time. Charging Triceratops goes after Wraith. And Crushing Hallway. Anomaly Trial. At the end of the environment turn, one player may discard their hand to destroy this card. At the start of the environment turn, deal each target 4 melee damage and destroy all hero ongoing cards. What? That's actually a bad card. I mean, it hits each target, which includes villain cards and environment cards, but we lose all of our ongoing cards. And, especially worse, the primary means of destroying this card is for a player to discard their hand, which is evil. Like, if Tempest discards his hand, he goes from 14 cards to 0 cards. If Scholar discards his hand, he can no longer fund his mortal forms to energy. If the Wraith discards her hand, obviously she doesn't have a card to play, but she can, you know, slowly get cards back via Infrared Eyepiece. But having to discard a hand means one player is going to lose their play phase. Fortunately, one of our heroes has a means of destroying environment cards. And a second hero also has a means of destroying it, except we haven't drawn that card yet, oddly. So we're not going to opt to destroy Crushing Hallway. We'll have the Wraith destroy it on her turn. The Genebound Banshee comes out that we've read already. And the damage goes that way. It goes towards Scholar. Scholar has the most ongoing cards in play. So now to fund Mortal Form to Energy, you have to discard 2 cards. So I believe we're going to lose the Grace Under Fire. And I don't need Flesh to Iron anymore. So Get Out of the Way would hit Genebound Banshee for 1. Scholar would gain 1, could hit Genebound Banshee twice, and then could do something else. Let's use Transmutative Recovery because he'll regain 2 HP and draw 2 cards. So we can hit the Banshee for 1 of these. And actually, we could hit Voss with 1 of these for 1 point of damage, and then have Better Living do 1 point of damage to the Banshee. I think we'll go ahead and take the Banshee out, because it doesn't matter if I do 1 point of damage reduced by 1 or 1 point of damage when it's the base amount. So we'll just get rid of the Genebound Banshee ourselves. And now it's gone. 2 cards we draw are another Alchemical Redirection and a Know When to Turn Loose. One shot, discard your hand. The Scholar deals 1 target X lightning damage, where X equals the number of cards discarded this way. Know When to Turn Loose is another potentially awesome card. It forces you to discard your hand, but you can deal a lot of damage. And the obvious use of this is as a, like, finisher. If you know you're going to win the game before the Scholar's next turn, you can use this to, you know, do the maximum damage possible. The only issue with this card is that you have to get cards in your hand, and these elementals force you to discard cards to keep them. Let's see, do I want to draw more cards? No, I think I have enough I can discard. So I'm going to go ahead and regain the 1 HP to hit Voss twice. And we draw and expect the worst. Ongoing limited. Whenever the Scholar would be dealt damage, reduce that damage to 0. At the start of your turn, the Scholar regains 2 HP and destroys this card. It's a pretty nice card, except right now we do want Scholar to take damage so we can regain things. So if I play Elemental Subwave Inducer right now, it's not going to have an immediate effect, but it will have an effect on the next turn. If I play Genebound Shackles, I will have increased damage to Voss right now. So I think I'm going to opt for that. Especially since Genebound Shackles is now in the game permanently. Let's deal up to two targets, three projectile damage. So Voss takes six. Because now Tempest is a damage-dealing machine to Voss. And we can also destroy the charging Triceratops, which would want to hit Tempest. And we draw another shielding winds. Oh yeah, two card draws from Localized Hurricane. We get the Otherworldly Resilience, ongoing limited, reduce damage dealt to Tempest by one. There's our damage reduction card. We get another Into the Stratosphere. So for Crushing Hallway to not wreck our ongoings, we have to destroy it with Grappling Hook. And Grappling Hook also lets us draw a card. The card we draw, Infrared Eyepiece. So first, let's take a look at Voss's deck. Top two cards. TCF Stalwart, Flagship. This card is immune to melee damage. At the start of the villain turn, this card deals each hero target 3 energy damage. At the end of the villain turn, shuffle the villain trash and reveal cards until a minion is revealed. Put it into play. Put the other revealed cards back into the trash. So when Voss plays this card, he is going to pull a minion from the villain trash and put it in play. And then the round after this card is played, it will hit each hero target for 3 energy damage. And since it has 18 HP, it's actually quite unlikely we will be able to destroy it by that next round. So if we don't want it to do bad things, we should just not put it on top of the villain deck. The other card, Genebound Ion Lancer, Minion. This card is immune to energy damage. At the end of the villain turn, this card deals the hero target with the lowest HP 2 energy damage. Excuse me. So this would hit Wraith currently, but Wraith can certainly take it. So let's put the Genebound Ion Lancer on top. We draw an Impromptu Invention, one shot, draw a card, search your deck for an equipment card, and either put it into play or your hand. Shuffle your deck. You may play a card. This is one of the best cards in the game. Cards that generally say draw a card, blah 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 blah, you may play a card, are great cards because you get all of the benefits on the card, as well as being able to play an additional card. So if you play it on your play phase, you get to play another card after, or in case there's other effects afterwards, you know, before other effects happen, you get to basically get more things to happen in a turn than just one card. I think I read once, like, there's a card in Magic, and forgive me for not knowing this because I don't actually play Magic, but I remember reading about this once. There's a card in Magic that basically says, search your deck for a card and put it into play, you may play a card. And that card was apparently so broken that they had to ban it from play, I think. Because being able to search your deck for any card means you can get any powerful card at all from your deck in play. As well as being able to play anything else. Again, I don't play Magic, so I don't know if that is a real story, but that would be a particularly strong card. And this card is almost as strong because although it only pulls equipment cards, Wraith's deck is primarily equipment cards, so it's pretty strong. Blah, blah, blah. Alright, so I could prevent the Ion Lancer damage by using Stealth. Actually, I wouldn't be able to because Voss would hit Wraith first. So let's use Throwing Knives to do 3 points of damage to Voss. And I could, again, hit the Scholar. I'm not going to do that. We draw Smoke Bombs. Equipment limited. Whenever a villain card would deal damage to the hero target with the lowest HP, redirect that damage to the hero target with the highest HP. Reduce damage redirected this way by 1. This is one of my favorite cards. The Wraith has a lot of really good cards in her deck. Smoke Bombs is particularly great. It doesn't allow for damage dealing directly. In fact, it doesn't allow for damage dealing at all, but it helps the hero with the lowest HP stay alive, redirect that damage to the hero with the highest HP, who, since they're highest HP, they're more capable of taking damage, but that damage is then reduced by 1, so it's less damage overall, and it's on a target that's more likely to take, or wants to take damage. So for instance, I no longer have to worry about Voss's 1 fire damage, because that's going to redirect to another hero, be reduced by 1. 1 minus 1 is 0, so it's 0 fire damage. Granted, if that target is then Tempest, the Nemesis boost would increase it by 1. And if, was it Field Lieutenant Tamar that had damage increased to hero targets? That would still prevent, that would still have the 1 point of damage go through. But still, this is a great card against Voss in a 3-hero setup, because now his lowest hero target damage is gone. Environment plays Tendrils of Madness, Anomaly. At the end of the environment turn, this card deals the target with the highest HP 1 infernal damage. Increase damage dealt by that target by 1 until the start of the environment turn. So, this is, you know, another damage increase to Voss, because he is the hero, or the target with the highest HP. Voss plays Genebound Ion Lancer, as we knew he would. Voss hits Scholar. Voss hits Wraith. Genebound Ion Lancer hits Wraith. So now we have to discard 2 to fund Mortal Form to Energy. As exciting as No Wind to Turn Loose is... Actually, I don't know. So Mortal Form to Energy is not going to be so good right now, because we can't get past... We can't hit the Genebound Ion Lancer. And Better Living won't get past Voss's damage reduction. We can hit Tendrils of Madness, but I don't want to waste damage in that direction. Not that I'm losing the Mortal Forms to Energy, but... a Get Out of the Way is currently not super effective, because it will... Actually, no. This will hit Ion Lancer and Tendrils of Madness for 1. He'll regain 2 HP, so that would get past Voss's damage reduction. We definitely want to keep the Transmutive Recovery. I would like to keep the Offensive Transmutation. I don't need to expect the worst. And I don't think I want Alchemical Redirection. So there we go. Alright, so... We are going to need to rely on Wraith or Tempest to get rid of the Genebound Ion Lancer, which they're more than capable of, for sure. So with that being said, I think we're going to use Bring What You Need. And the card that I'm going to play is Offensive Transmutation. This will hit Voss for 1. It will prevent him from dealing damage. And so the Tendrils of Madness is not going to increase damage dealt by Voss by 1. This also means I don't have to play Smoke Bombs with... Well, I guess I could still play Smoke Bombs with Wraith. And then let's go ahead and bring what I need to get enough cards to fund the Mortal Forms to Energy. We gotta keep moving, a Mortal Form to Energy, and a No Wind to Hold Fast. So I think the right answer is the same as previously. Put the Mortal Form to Energy on the bottom and draw the Keep Moving. So we're gonna get a No Wind to Hold Fast out of this deal. And yeah, that's... Oh, we drew second, No Wind to Hold Fast. That's what happened. Okay, right. Okay. So. Wraith does have Impromptu Inventions, so she could get out any equipment that she wants. Let's see. I'm just thinking out loud. I don't think I want to Chain Lightning. I could chain ball lightning. I don't want to ball lightning. I could chain lightning. I could elemental cell wave inducer. I think we're gonna otherworldly resilience just to counter the localized hurricane effect. And we'll go ahead and get rid of the genebound ion lancer first so that Voss takes the maximum damage. Otherworldly resilience is actually a pretty safe play. I probably could have just played a damage dealer, because I have a lot of damage dealing potential, and I might as well utilize my +2 to Voss. But whatever. We draw another Aquatic Correspondence, we draw Reclaim from the Deep, and we draw an Electrical Storm. Ongoing Limited. At the start of your turn, Tempest deals each non-hero target 1 lightning damage. Alright, so we are almost undoubtedly playing Impromptu Invention, because equipment cards are permanently in play. And we get to play a card after we play it. So let's go ahead and do that. First action is to draw a card, and the card we draw is another Impromptu Invention. So now we get to play 2 of these and get 2 equipments in play. So some of the equipments that we haven't seen yet. Mega Computer. Equipment. Reduce damage dealt by environment cards by 1. This is actually pretty effective in this environment, because a lot of the cards Well, we've seen a lot that deal 3 damage, but like Surprise Shopping Trip dealt 1 damage. Several other cards also deal only 1 point of damage. Like the Tendrils of Madness that is currently out. So if I play Mega Computer, it negates a lot of the environment cards. Razor Ordnance, Equipment Limited, Power. The Wraith deals 1 target, 3 projectile damage. Stunbolt, Equipment, Power. The Wraith deals 1 target, 1 projectile damage. Until the start of your next turn, reduce all damage dealt by that target by 1. One of the nice things about this card is that you don't actually have to deal damage to that target to have that damage reduction effect happen. So if the Wraith damage is redirected, it still prevents, or it still reduces damage dealt by that target by 1. This would be a nice card to get out on Voss at some point. So we should think about what we're going to potentially get in play with her main card play. We have a Smoke Bombs in hand. We already have a micro-targeting computer in play. We already have an infrared eyepiece in play. We have a combat stance we would like to play at some point, but Voss can't deal damage right now. And since Voss can't deal damage right now, Stunbolt is not 100% useful right now, but we do have 2 impromptu inventions, so it can be put into play by one of these. But I think for maximum damage dealing potential, we should of course put Razor Ordnance in play. We do have the option of putting it in our hand, but I'm going to put it in play, because equipments are permanent, with the exception of Inventory Barrage, which we're not playing right now. I don't know if I mentioned the effects of this card, but once you have a lot of equipments in play, you can destroy all of them to deal a lot of damage, and it's usually as a finisher so that you can wipe out the villain. We'll certainly play the second impromptu invention. The card we draw is another Grappling Hook. So we have a choice between, we have Smoke Bombs in play, we have a Combat Stance we would like to play at some point. But the only equipment that we, or the 2 equipments we don't have yet are Mega Computer and Stunbolt. I think we're going to go for Stunbolt. Yes. We'll put that in play as well. We get to play a card. I'm going to put Smoke Bombs. It's not going to help with Voss's damage, but in the case that we reveal a card that deals damage to the lowest HP hero, that will be slightly better to have in play. So first, let's go ahead and take a look at what Voss is doing. We have a Genebound Guard minion, reduced damage dealt to villain targets by 1. And we have a Genebound Psyweaver minion. This card is immune to psychic damage. At the end of the villain turn, this card deals each hero target 2 psychic damage. So the Genebound Guard doesn't deal damage himself, and he's the only minion that doesn't have a damage immunity. But the Psyweaver hits all of us for 2. Smoke Bombs would redirect Wraith's damage to either Scholar or Tempest. We'd probably want it to hit Scholar for, since we want to hit Scholar more. Genebound Guard provides damage reduction, which will make him a little harder to hit, especially with Scholar. So let's put the Genebound Psyweaver on top. And we draw a Trust Fund, 1 shot, draw 4 cards, then discard 2 cards. We have a lot of cards already. I mean, we have most of the equipments that we want in play anyway, so we're probably not going to go ahead and play that anytime soon. Razor Ordnance would do more damage to Voss. We don't have to worry about the Tendrils of Madness right now, so I'm going to do more damage to Voss. And we draw another Utility Belt. So, environment plays Giant Mutated Specimen, Anomaly Cockroach. At the end of the environment turn, this card deals the 2 targets with the highest HP 1 toxic damage each. So, this is one of the cards that deals 1 toxic damage, and it would have been negated by the Mega Computer. The good news is it's going to hit Voss. It's also going to hit either Scholar or Tempest. The first Tendrils of Madness hits Voss. Voss has damage increase, but he can't deal damage. Since Voss is going to hit the highest HP hero, we might as well hit Tempest with this, because we don't want Tempest to get the damage, or the Nemesis bonus, from Voss. There's the Genebound Psyweaver we knew was coming. Voss can't deal damage. Oh, right. Voss can't deal damage. That was not what I totally forgot that was going to happen. All right, so that redirects to the Scholar because of smoke bombs, and then this doesn't matter because these two will always be higher than Wraith. So now we have to discard two cards to fund Mortal Form to Energy. So I'm going to get rid of Know When to Turn Loose and Know When to Hold Fast, just because they are both no cards. Keep moving into my third and final Mortal Form to Energy. And now I'm going to get out of the way. I think. Yes, I'm going to get out of the way. This will be at maximum effect with the three mortal forms to energy. This can't hit Voss because of the Psyweaver reducing his damage, but it will hit the Psyweaver and the environment cards. Scholar regains 3 HP, and now he's going to deal 3 energy damage 3 times. So I could have all of these hit Voss. This will do 2, 2, and 2, which is 6. If I hit Psyweaver and then Voss twice, that will be 3 and 3 to Voss. That's also 6, but it also takes out the Psyweaver, which is slightly nice, slightly better. So let's do that. So now with the three mortal forms to energy, I'm discarding three cards to keep all of these cards in play. If I use his base power, he'll regain 1 HP and then deal 1 point of damage 3 times. I feel like Bring What You Need is a little better because I want to keep Get Out of the Way and Transmutative Recovery for the mortal form to energy combos. So let's go ahead and Bring What We Need again. Get a Truth Seeker. We haven't seen this card yet. Ongoing Limited. Power. The Scholar deals 1 target, 2 melee damage. Draw 1 card. It gets you 1 more card, as well as deal damage, which might be a little better than Better Living, because if I didn't have all the Mortal Forms energy out, Better Living might not deal damage. And then Get Out of the Way again, and then another Expect the Worst. Although Expect the Worst does have HP recovery, I think I'm going to prefer it to be on the bottom of my deck. So let's get a Get Out of the Way and the Truth Seeker in my hand. We'll put the Expect the Worst on the bottom of the deck, and we draw Flesh to Iron. Alright. I think we should really focus more on capitalizing damage right now. Ordinarily, I would play Electrical Storm because this provides start of turn damage for a while, and being able to deal damage indiscriminately in this game is not a bad thing. There are some games where you don't want to deal damage indiscriminately. There might be some targets you want to leave in play. But we want to deal maximum damage. Ideally, I win the game on the next turn, or next round. Chain Lightning would deal 4 damage, 3 damage, 2 damage. Chain Lightning would deal 4 damage, and then there aren't any cards to discard, and there are no other cards that deal damage outside of Grievous Hailstorm that provides a power that deals less damage than Localized Hurricane to a single target. So let's play Chain Lightning for maximum effect, and we'll hit Voss with the biggest hit, which is 7 lightning damage. That's a massive amount. And then let's just hit Tendrils of Madness and Mutated Specimen in that order, not that it matters at all. And then Localized Hurricane is the better option. Hits Voss for 6. I think if I hit Tendrils of Madness, I don't have to worry about Voss's damage at all. So we'll do that. 2 cards we draw. A Flash Flood, 1-shot. Destroy up to 2 environment cards. We also draw a Lightning Slash, 1-shot. Tempest deals 1 target, 5 lightning damage. That's a lot by itself. And another Elemental Subwave Inducer. Alright, so we have 7 equipments in play. Inventory Barrage is going to do 14 damage right now. There's only one other equipment we could play to power up Inventory Barrage. Alternatively, I play Combat Stance, although no villain target is going to hit Wraith right now, so that's not a thing. I would want to do. So let's put out infrared eyepiece to power up the later inventory barrage. I don't know that I want to control the villain deck, because even if a force deployment comes out, I should win the game on the next turn. Quark Drive Translocator, if it enters play, you know, it doesn't do anything by itself. If it comes into play, I'll read what it says. These other minions can be dealt with. Ideally, we get the TCF Stalwart. No, we already saw the TCF Stalwart. Ideally, we get the TCF Conqueror, because it doesn't prevent, or it doesn't reduce damage to Scholar, and it will hit hero targets for 3 fire, but that's not a big deal. I think I just want to do more damage. I want to do maximum damage right now. It's the Jeremy style of doing things. So we'll hit Voss for 3, and then I'm going to reduce Voss's damage. Just, I could take out the mutated specimen, but it's going to hit Voss for 1 point of damage. Although currently Scholar is the highest HP, fun fact. We draw a second combat stance. So now we don't know what the villain's going to play, but that's fine. Actually, it's slightly less fine. Uh-oh. I'm gonna hate myself if Voss now plays a card. Main computer room. Anomaly. At the end of the environment turn, play the top card of the villain deck. At the start of the environment turn, each player may draw a card. This might be, you know, what happens when you get cocky. But first, the mutated specimen hits Voss and Scholar, and now the main computer room plays Genebound Firesworn. It would have been karmic justice if this had been a forced deployment, because it would destroy itself as soon as we get to Voss's turn, and then gets all these minions out, and now Voss has damage reduction by however many minions. I forgot about the main computer room. This is always like a learning moment. Even when you think the game's over, it's not over, because the environment is still an entity, and if the environment provides villain card plays, you probably don't want cards to enter play right before the villain turn, especially ones that act at the start of the villain turn. So there you have it. This is fine, though. Voss then plays a forced deployment. I think we did read this. Yeah, we did. But because of all the damage reduction, that's fine. So you have to discard 3 cards to keep the mortal form to energy train living. So I think get out of the way is again the best play. So let's get lose the flesh to iron, let's lose the truth seeker, let's lose a know when to hold fast. Let's play the get out of the way. This won't hit Voss, but it will hit the other guys. Nope, it won't hit the Fire Sworn, he's immune to fire damage. So that's a little bit of a bummer. Still, we are going to regain 2 HP, which is the same amount that Transmutive Recovery would regain. So, let's see. This is going to do 1 point of damage to Voss. So I think it's still better to hit Fire Sworn twice to get rid of it, and then hit Voss. And now let's not bring what I need. We're going to try to win. Better living, regain an HP, and then hit Voss 3 times. We draw solid to liquid. Alright. So, just to be fully safe, although I'm almost certain we've won at this point, we're going to into the Stratosphere, the Force Deployment. Because this will hit Voss. Not for as much as a Lightning Slash would, but it does hit Voss. And then we're going to localize the Hurricanes. I mean, if I had Lightning Slash, we would have won, so I guess I should have Lightning Slashed. I mean, the safest way to beat the game is to beat the game. Don't worry about cards if they're not going to have effects. I'm going to hit the main computer room with this, and we get an Electrical Storm. Oh yeah, multiple cards. Electrical Storm, we already read Genebound Shackles, and Electrical Storm. Alright. So we can win right now by playing Inventory Barrage, so I always like going out with the bang. Order could matter in card destruction. I don't think it matters in this environment. But in, like, Omnitron 4, which I played recently, but it wasn't in a one-shot, there is a card that takes, at the start of your turn, if the top card of your trash is an equipment card, put it into your hand. No, it puts it into play, rather, so it's even better. It puts the equipment card into play. But in this case, it doesn't matter, because the game's over. We've won. Whoop-de-doo. That was a rather straightforward game. Got a little scared that we could have had a forced deployment nightmare because I prematurely celebrated, but we can at least take that as a learning moment. Don't do that yourself, folks, because the game's not over until it's over. Yeah, that was a pretty good game. I don't really have many comments to say. Wraith is pretty good at getting set up and doing things when she's set up. Scholar has a lot of options. We started with a tanking Scholar since everything was hitting the highest HP hero, so we didn't take as much damage as we potentially could have in that game. And Tempest could have gotten a little screwed if that surprise shopping trip had entered play when, Localized Hurricane was in play, because he would have taken 2 damage for each card played. But really, like, we were doing pretty well. We also had a Cleansing Downpour in our hand that we never played because I played more offensively. I could have played more offensively with Tempest, actually. I played a damage reduction card, and after the fact, I thought to myself, I might as well have just dealt more damage to Voss, because Gene Bound Shackles and Nemesis Boost always increases damage dealt by Tempest to Voss by 3. So I might as well have played as much damage dealing as I could have with Tempest. But yeah. I hope this was a useful video. I hope you enjoyed this. I hope you got entertainment from it. I hope you played this one-shot yourself. It doesn't seem like it was a terrible one-shot. It seemed like it was rather straightforward. It would have been a lot worse if it was advanced. But it wasn't. But again, I hope you enjoyed this. This is Lou Dolphin. Tuning out. What's the word? I don't remember what the phrase is. I'm heading out, I guess. I don't know. Whatever. Bye.